It's Christmas time. There's no need to be afraid. At Christmas time, we let in light and we banish shade. There's a world outside your window, and it's a world of dread and fear. And the Christmas bells that ring there are the clanging chimes of doom. The greatest gift they'll get this year is life. Do they know it's Christmas time at all? Let's read God's word. Please turn to Luke chapter 2. Luke chapter 2, verses 1 to 14, the birth of Jesus. About that time, Caesar Augustus ordered a census to be taken throughout the empire. This was the first census when Quirinius was governor of Syria. Everyone had to travel to his own ancestral hometown to be counted. So Joseph went from the Galilean town of Nazareth up to Bethlehem in Judah, David's town, for the census. As a descendant of David, he had to go there. He went with Mary, his fiancée, who was pregnant. While they were there, the time came for her to give birth. She gave birth to a son, her firstborn. She wrapped him in a blanket and laid him in a manger, because there was no room in the inn. There were shepherds camping in the neighborhood. They had set watch over their sheep. Suddenly, God's angel stood among them, and God's glory blazed around them. They were terrified. The angel said, "Don't be afraid. I'm here to announce a great and joyful event that is meant for everybody worldwide. A savior has just been born in David's town, a savior who is Messiah and Master. This is what you're to look for, a baby wrapped in a blanket and lying in a manger." At once, the angel was joined by a huge angelic choir singing God's praises. "Glory to God in the heavenly heights. Peace to all men and women on earth who please him." This is the word of the Lord. Peace to all men and women on earth. What does that mean? What can we expect? What does peace mean to a soldier? To a mother of a sick infant, to a child whose parents won't stop fighting. It usually means the end of something, the end of a conflict, the end of non-stop crying, the end of a terrifying dispute. So what kind of peace are the angels declaring? Is it the peace that I've just described? Not really. All those are at best temporary forms of peace. Nations will rise up against nations. Babies will get sick and cry again. Relationships will continue to break down. The Jews were looking for a Messiah. They were looking for a king who would end the war of occupation by the Romans. But the angels were declaring the end of another war, or at least the beginning of the end of that war. At the beginning of God's creation, one of God's most beautiful and powerful angels, Lucifer, became proud. Lucifer, the morning star. In Greek, the name given is Phosphorus, light bringer. He decided he knew better than his creator, and he chose to go his own way. And with him went a third of the heavenly host. And since that day, war has raged and rages even now. A few years ago, I went to a play which described this conflict from the view of the angels. It was called And There Was War. I want to show you a little trailer for that.
I'm all for Emmanuel.
All he is love.
He is the provider, he is the path.
He's what's true and just.
The greatest power is only the power that Emmanuel holds.
He is the truth, and he's all that I will ever need.
Follow me,
I'm the right person for the job.
I followed him because he made me question everything so much.
I guess he gave us freedom, choice to be who we're really meant to be.
His aim is to liberate us, set us free from that tyrant.
Lucifer allowed his desires to take control over him.
Bring him back to us.
I feel sorry for him.
Surely, you know him. You know his every fault.
And I wish that he could find his way back.
I'm upset.
This is absurd. Please.
He was loved, and he chose his own path.
They have no inspiration. He just pretended to love us. He's jealous of our freedom.
He's a controller.
All of us who left heaven, I think we really have seen the light.
He didn't want us to grow, to see our full potential, who we really are.
They haven't been allowed to question everything.
I feel like now we are doing the right thing to be against him.
We've all placed in every individual a choice that they have to make.
They chose right. God, the man wouldn't listen to us. All the man who cares about is himself.
No, I don't think I would go back. If I had the only choice, I don't think I would go back, no.
My name is Faith.
My name is Charity.
Gabriel.
I'm in the highest order of the ninefold celestial beings.
The Seraphim.
I'm Maya. I'm a bad angel.
My name is Enio.
I'm Loki.
Lucifer. The son of the morning. Emmanuel.
I am.
And so we see that every war, every conflict between nations, between tribes, between religions, between individuals, has its roots in this heavenly war and is fueled by the hatred and anger and greed which flows from the pit of hell itself. And so on that mountainside, 2,000 years ago, the angels came to declare the beginning of the end of this war. It's interesting that these angels did not bring this wonderful message of Christ's birth to the wealthy or to political or religious leaders. Instead, they came to the least significant, least respected, least likely people in the community. The shepherds, men who herded livestock for a living, who were at the very bottom of the social structure. You've heard people say things like, she swears like a sailor. Well, in those days, there was a saying, he lies like a shepherd. I mean, fairly or unfairly, the character of a shepherd was not highly regarded. The work was dirty and dangerous. Shepherds were exposed to all the elements in all seasons. Men who were shepherds usually had no other work choices. So when God's messenger said he came to bring good news to all people, he demonstrated it by starting at the bottom. First, there was one angel, probably Gabriel, who previously appeared to Mary and to Zechariah. Then he was joined in verse 13 with a great company of angels. I once heard someone describe this as the great company hiding behind the clouds to get to watch Gabriel as he announced this to the shepherds. And as more and more of them squeezed in, suddenly they all fell out and came into view. And so they thought, better start singing. Anyway, back to peace. The peace that Gabriel announces is a great and joyful event that's meant for everybody worldwide. God is telling us the war that has pulled everything apart, that makes the whole of creation groan, as it says in Romans, is finally coming to an end. 30 years later, Jesus would declare, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He sent me to proclaim liberty to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. As Jesus lived his life sinless and obedient to his Father, and as he went on to teach and to show us how to live, and then on to the cross, he opened the way to peace for us all. The peace that only Jesus the Messiah can bring is a personal and permanent kind of peace. Peace between self-absorbed, willful, sinful people like you and me and the holy Creator God. The angels declare peace to all those that God favours. And this is not a promise to those who try their best or to those who are recognised as successful or to those who are good. Rather, it's for the poor, the broken, the sinners who understand our failure and embrace the mercy that God offers. God is offering a chance for us to have peace with him first and in our relationships with each other. I'd like to promise you that this Christmas you'll have peace in all your relationships, but I can't, because our old self-centered selves rise up all too easily. The Bible doesn't promise it either. It says, if it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. It recognises there will be disputes, conflicts. And this verse has both personal and national implications. There are peoples and groups of peoples who are so filled with self-interest and hate that they think nothing of taking for themselves what belongs to another. It's wishful thinking to believe that because of Jesus, we will never experience interpersonal conflict or be free from conflict between nations and people. Some of us live very much in the here and now. Others tend to live too far out into the future, dreaming. And some of you will live in the past, thinking of what has been. The angel's song gives us the hope of peace for our past. If there's anything in our past that still causes you shame, embarrassment, or guilt, then this song promises you you can be at peace. If there's anything in your past that brings you sadness, grief, or loneliness, this song promises that you can be at peace. If there's anything in your past that brings you regret over things done or said that hurt people you love, this song promises you that you can be at peace. The Bible says in Psalm 103, verse 12, as far as the east is from the west, so far as he removed our transgressions from us. The slate is wiped clean with God. All things are new with him. When we get a big snowfall, everything is fresh and pure and clean, as it says in Isaiah 1, verse 18, though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be white as snow. And when the baby we celebrate reached the end of his life, he said to his followers in John 14, I'm leaving you with a gift, peace of mind and heart. And the peace I give isn't fragile like the peace the world gives. So don't be troubled or afraid. We often think of peace as being without trials and troubles, the absence of pain and suffering and heartache. That kind of peace, whilst admittedly it's nice, can't be sustained, not in this world. So we will need a peace that transcends circumstance, that allows us to rise above the urgency of the immediate, that allows us to have a clear head and a peaceful heart in the midst of the chaos that defines contemporary life. And finally, the angel's song gives us hope of a peace for the future. The truth is that many things could happen to us all. Few of us will live lives free from tragedy, and all of us will know sorrow. Human cruelty and lack of regard for the sanctity of life has always been with us. And Jesus said himself, you will always have the poor with you. If we could get a glimpse of heaven today, we would hear the heavenly host singing, glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace to men on whom his favour rests. Hundreds of years before Jesus was born, the prophet Isaiah proclaimed peace with a song of his own. For to us a child is born, To us, a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Peace can be found no matter what the circumstances, because Jesus has won the war. The turning point in the war came 33 years after this announcement, when Jesus died and rose again and defeated Satan. And we live now in the end times as God, through us, the church, pushes back the enemy and frees the captives that he has taken. And through this time, God has given us peace which surpasses understanding. And this is the peace we must live in. Oswald Sanders, great writer, said very simply, peace is not the absence of trouble, but the presence of God. And I pray that that presence of the risen Lord Jesus will be with you all this Christmas. Have a blessed Christmas. Amen.